at the important decision-making quandary. It's going to be a brief presentation of the situation with available published literature on this issue. It's always an equipoise. What am I supposed to do when I'm offered a disease on a kidney with a raised creatinine? There are two options. Some people, as a knee-jerk reaction, they simply say no. They simply take a decision to discard. On the other hand, many people, many centers, they think the other way around and they try to utilize the organ. Both arguments can be correct. There are points to argue in favor of utilization of an organ with care. An equal number of points are there to take a decision to discard as well. What are the problems of utilizing such a kidney with acute kidney injury is that obviously the hospitalization of the recipient is going to be prolonged with the cost implications. And the most worrisome is that whether there is increased likelihood of primary non-function of such a graft. That is there. And the current knowledge says is that however mild it is, an insult to the kidney is an insult and an insult. Even the recovery, what we document is, can be only apparent recovery. Whether such a graft is going to have a poorer long-term outcome. So that is a major worry. I just explain on this particular point before we discuss on the available literature. The current concept is that to consider AKI and CKD as a single continuum, different aspects in a single continuum. Now we fairly know what starts apparently as the AKI progresses to CKD. There are three important mechanisms. One is the hypoxia. That is because of the rarefaction of the peritubular microvascular microcirculation and initiation of inflammatory pathways. Even what starts as a purely ischemic insult, there can be initiation of inflammatory pathways that ultimately culminate in conversion of the interstitial cells into kind of a fibroblast and results in fibrosis. And the severity and frequency of episodes of AKI is related to progression of CKD. And injury to the proximal tibial is the key determinant for CKD progression. And inadequate repair of the proximal tibial is the key cellular mechanism. These are the current knowledge. And further expansion of the same topic, there are multiple mechanisms how AKI progresses to CKD, including the tubular epithelial cell arrest, preventing a proper regeneration, microvascular rarefaction, inflammation, mitochondrial dysfunction, the genetic susceptibility, and the hyperfiltration of the surviving glomeruli and RAS activation and so on. So this is the background why many people advocate that. Many people are rather scared of using graft AKI. But are we right? What does the literature say? This is an important article. Why? Because it is involving a large number of disease donor kidneys, about 11,200 kidneys, of whom 17% are with AKI, a significant number. This is from the United Kingdom Transplant Registry. It is an observational study over a decade of 2003-13. The parameters that were studied are occurrence of delayed graft function, the primary non-function, eGFR at 3 months and 1 year. The study results are the DGF and primary non-function risk is increasing in grafts with AKI, but a significant risk happens only in AKI stage 3. This staging, all the published literature, they follow the Akin network staging. In the same study, there was no significant difference in the eGFR at 3 months, but 1 year graft survival was 89% versus 91% in the donors without AKI as compared to the donors with AKI. The authors say that even though it is statistically significant, the clinical relevance of this particular observed difference of 2% was not great enough. How about long-term outcome? As you can see here, this is the depiction at 1 year. How about long-term outcome? They were not able to come out with certainty of the long-term outcome because of missing data. But with the available follow-up and data on follow-up, a 3-year transplant survival, again there was a statistically significant difference between the cohort with AKI and the cohort without AKI. And the same as in 5-year survival as well, 78% versus 76%. But the authors go on discussing, if we discard a kidney with AKI and the patient continues to be on hemodialysis, what will happen? There's an annual death rate while on transplant which is about 8.2%. And we now know that the dialysis vintage, that is the quantum of period a person who is on maintenance dialysis before he gets a kidney, the more the dialysis vintage, the more the likelihood for graft failure. So considering these factors, they conclude saying that even though there is a small reduction in 1-year graft survival of kidneys from donor to AKI, stage 1 and 2 AKI kidneys should be used, and we have to be cautious when we take a decision of accepting a kidney with AKI stage 3. So this is their observation. Move on to a study from the United States. It's a multicentric cohort study about 1,000 disease donors. As you can see here, as the staging of AKI progresses, the discard rate of the graft increases. The relative risk of discard of the kidney with attained stage 3 was 2.74 compared to kidney without AKI. And similarly, there was an increased risk for delayed graft function as the staging of AKI goes up, the relative risk being 2.25 when it comes to a graft with AKI stage 3. But again, when the cohort was followed, EGFR, the serum creatinine at 6 months, there was no significant difference in the graft function at 6 months. As you can see here, the donors without AKI and with AKI 1, 2, 3, there is no significant difference in the serum creatinine at 6 months. But if you do a subset analysis, there was very exciting and interesting observation that here, as you can see here, recipients without BGF, again there was no significant difference in the serum creatinine in 6 months. But in the subset of patients who suffer an episode of delayed graft function, how was the serum creatinine at 6 months? A person who suffered a delayed graft function, receiving a kidney without AKI, the serum creatinine was more contrary to the expectation. As you can compare here, this is the average serum creatinine in 6 months of those who had DGF but suffered different stages of AKI. The conclusion is that there is a very interesting interaction between AKI and DGF. To explain further, so this is, look at this diagram. So this is no AKI, stage 1 AKI, stage 2 AKI, stage 3 AKI, 6 months EGFR. The blue line, there was no DGF. So this is understandable. If you look at the serum creatinine at 6 months, without AKI, but with progressively increasing severity of AKI, 6 months EGFR, that serum creatinine is lower. This is simple. But look at the red line. All these patients had an episode of PGF post-transplant. The 6 months serum creatinine of the persons who had DGF, but at the same time received a kidney with AKI, they did better. Why is this? This is a kind of ischemic precondition which we all have read about. What is this ischemic precondition? AKI initiates inflammatory and repair pathways and increases the DGF risk, but increased capability of the successful repair. This is a very interesting phenomenon. It requires further explanations, and a lot of research is required on this. And based on this, the others conclude that the donor AKI is associated with the kidney discard and increased likelihood for delayed graft function. But the 6-month allograft graft function is fairly okay, and we should cautiously accept the kidneys with AKI as well. This is the favorable conclusion. Should we read about the outcome of grafts with AKI as a single cohort, or we have to stratify into those kidneys retrieved from standard criteria donors and those kidneys retrieved from expanded criteria donors? Is there any difference? That is the purpose of this particular study, scientific registry of transplant recipients. About 16,978 kidneys were from the expanded criteria donor and 82,000 kidneys from the standard criteria donor. What is the conclusion? There is a progressively worse long-term allograft survival for recipients of the ECD kidneys with increasing AKA severity, but not for standard criteria donor. So this is an interesting observation again. So this is the available data published in different literatures. All these are not homogeneous. Some of them are single centers, some of them are multiple centers, and different duration of follow-up. But overall trend of all this published literature is that there is no statistically significant difference in terms of the outcome of the graft as long as 3 years and so on. But none of the studies, but for one, this is a 5-year graft survival, there's no statistically significant difference between the grafts with AKA and without AKA. But there are not many studies who have really studied the long-term outcome. And that way I consider this study is very important published in Hotel General Medicine. This is a single center study coming from King Faisal Hospital, Riyadh, Saudi Arabia. It's a kind of a retrospective study where they have studied 114 donor kidneys with AKI. Both the recipients and a donor, they are in the prime part of their life, you know, 35 and 36 and 37 years, the mean age. They have studied all the increased, the DGF, occurrence of DGF, and the serum creatinine at discharge, and the duration of hospitalization and so on. The observation is that the cohort who received kidneys with AKI, there was increased likelihood for DGF, and higher serum creatinine at discharge and prolonged hospital stay. But there was no increase in the acute rejection risk in the cohort who received kidneys from with AKI. This is very interesting. They were able to follow the patients up to 10 years, even more than that. As you can see here, there was no statistically significant difference in the outcome of the graft. How to explain this phenomenon? I haven't discussed so much about the potential implications of negative implications of even a single episode of AKA on the outcome, but here it is not relevant here. Here comes the difference. AKI happening routinely is different from AKI in the sense that there are multiple factors here. See, as you can see here, the donor age is 35 and the mean age of the recipient is only 36. And the donors who have suffered AKI, who have donated kidneys, retrieved kidney organs, they were absolutely healthy otherwise. So probably that makes a difference. So instead of considering it's a kind of a binary, either to use or to discard, I think we have to follow a kind of a cautious, a third line approach, make a considered decision in every clinical scenario. And instead of just depending on the serum creatinine, we have to take a kind of a holistic assessment, which includes age, height, weight, cause of death of the donor, presence or absence of hypertension, diabetes, and so on. So the current concept is the overall holistic assessment of the risk index and so on. A cutoff of kidney disease, the risk index score of 1.2, if it is more than, they say better, avoid the kidney and so on. So the decision making has to be a holistic assessment, and based on the available literature, I think we can draw a conclusion saying that stage 1 and 2 AKI, I think we can safely accept, and when it comes to AKI stage 3, we have to take a kind of a considered decision. And thanks for your patient here.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your good presentation. I now open the session for questions from the audience.
Thank you, Dr. Babakrishnan. One of the things which you mentioned were the recipient characteristics. And in India, many recipients, the nutrition status is poor. That also determines how much insult they can take, the body can take. And perhaps that's maybe one reason why they don't do so well compared to what the Western literature shows. And you're right, AKI is from a young donor. If you get a kidney which has had AKI, the chances of it working is so much higher than an older kidney with AKI. Right. I think we may have to design our own protocol rather than going by the Western literature. I also want to tell you that US, which is one of the largest transplanting centers for disease donation, they do discard 1,500 kidneys every year. 1,500 kidneys is a large amount. So in India, I think if we collect our data together and we do some analysis and we do some prospective studies on all this disease donation, we need to look at outcomes, we need to look at different characteristics. It's about time, at least in Tamil Nadu, that we need to do some collection and sit down at the prospect and come out with our own criteria, kidneys with AKI is my question.
Your points are well taken, sir. Actually, as of now, what we do is that AKI stage 1 and 2, we accept. Stage 3, we don't. The same thing is, you know, like in prolonged hospitalization. And as you rightly said, particularly in a government setup, the recipients are already malnourished and they are not in the fit of their health. And also there is a problem of how the tailoring the immunosuppression. What we do is that whenever there is AKI kidney and TGF, we don't try to achieve the target CNA level. We deliberately maintain a CNA level at a low level and we go for induction immunosuppression. Because, you know, if you maintain a high CNA level, that may prolong the ischemic injury and can delay the recovery of the kidney function and so on. So practically that problem also stays. In addition to just the outcome, even immediate management itself poses certain issues. So as of now, with milder degrees of kidney impairment, we do accept up to 1.5 milligram, even 2 milligrams. And beyond that, we don't dare. As you rightly said, it's high time to kind of collate all the data from all the centers and think of our own experience.
My question is, if there is a brain dead donor and that urine shows that protein and SPAT urine shows significant proteinuria, so what is your advice, accept or not to accept that donor?
The donor?
Yeah, brain dead donor.
Yes.
Urine is showing proteinuria.
Anyhow, that is a different topic. Anyhow, what we do is ideally what has been done and what we do. I'll just quote one instance where the disease donor was diabetic. And there was proteinuria, 2 plus proteinuria, and creatinine was known. And fairly significant duration of diabetes, about, I don't remember exactly, about 8 years of diabetes and so on, and 58 years old, and mild hypertension as well. We could take a decision because creatinine was normal. And we requested frozen section biopsy. The frozen section biopsy revealed features of diabetic retinopathy, diabetic nephropathy. Even there was one mesangial nodule. Initially, we thought this kidney cannot be used at all. But we quickly made a literature search. The literature says that if there is no chronicity of pathology in the interstitium, just a single mesangial nodule, that's a KW lesion, is by itself is not a deterrent for use. So we explained in detail to the recipient about the potential implications, and she very much wanted to have a kidney. We went ahead with the transplant. It worked well. Despite being a disease donor transplant, we didn't use tacrolimus. We used cyclosporine so that we were extremely careful not to induce NODAC in that person. 1 year later, there was a mild gut dysfunction. We did a biopsy. There was no trace of the nodule or anything. So it was a kind of a learning experience for us.
Yes,
so
yes,
mere proteinuria, I think we have to take a decision. With the preserved kidney function by itself is not a kind of a precluding factor. But if it is an FSGS, again, the question is that, you know, there is a problem. But ideally in such situations, we have to go for a kind of a frozen section, but frozen section facilities are not available everywhere. So.
Because I can give you the example, we had a 28-year donor. And his urine was showing protein, so we did SPAT protein, which came out around 2.7. And then there was a too much of that, kidney should not be taken. But there were two desperate patients who were waiting. So we discussed them, we told them that this is our plan. They accepted. So we took out the kidney, we did frozen section was normal, kidney was transplanted. And when we reperfused, we took another biopsy from the kidneys, both the centers. And the kid biopsy came out to be normal and both patients did well and they don't have any proteinuria. So sometimes in acute sitting when there is a brain injury and so many things are happening, some of these results could be fallacious.
Right.
Last comment, then we move to the next speaker.
So with a little experience, I can say that...
You are not audible to me.
Hello.
Use the other mic, sir.
With little experience, I can say that initial phase, the patient may have some hemodynamic changes also. At least, we have seen in some of the patients, after 1 or 2 days, they have stabilized their retina and it has came down from something 1 point something. So at least, we can wait in some of the patients and then after that, we can reassess the things and we can go ahead with the things.
Thank sir. We proceed with the